Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Now, I have to tell you this. I am proud of you 8:30 people. A lot of you did show up. Well, we're in for a treat. The music is outstanding. Bishop Park is a very good speaker. Just a couple of quickies. I understand if you're part of the gift-giving packages for the Santa luncheon, you need to have those angel tree gifts into the church today. They want to get all that stuff organized. It's a lot to organize, so if you haven't brought your gift in yet, please do so sometime today. You can look over other announcements. At the conclusion of our service, the handbells have a beautiful postlude. So it starts off, I think, a little soft. If you would just like to stay seated after the benediction, Bishop Park will be giving the benediction and the blessing for our luncheon. We will be escorting slowly out to the gym, and after the postlude, if you would kindly just, those of you signing up for lunch, just meander down and we'll take a seat and then we'll begin the luncheon. Just a little bit of bio on Bishop Jeremiah Park. He and I were ordained elder the same year. He's a lot older than me, though, he told me. But he doesn't look a lot older. He was ordained in 1981 at Western New York Annual Conference by Bishop Yackel. Yes, Bishop Yackel. Upon his election to becoming a bishop, the episcopacy by the Northeastern Jurisdictional Conference back in 2004, Bishop Park was assigned as resident bishop of the New York area back up until 2012, when he presides now in the Susquehanna Annual Conference. But this is interesting. I had learned this some time ago. Bishop Park also is the presiding bishop of the Mongolian Mission and the Northeastern Jurisdictional Korean American Mission, and as president of the General Commission on Archives and History. Bishop Park, we welcome you and your lovely wife, Mrs. Park. If you want to just stand that we can recognize this lovely lady. Welcome. Dear ones, let's now prepare our hearts and minds as we worship together in this morning hour. Thank you.
As we light this second candle, we hear the word, come, come all ye faithful, come and behold him, come a newborn king to see, come let us adore him.
And they did come, Mary and Joseph to the stable, angels to sing glad tidings, shepherds who heard the good news, wise men who followed the star.
And they have come throughout the ages, young and old, rich and poor, humble and proud, peasant and king. And we are still coming,
that through the inspiration of this humble act of Christ's birth, we will kneel before this manger, experience this forgiving grace and redeeming love, and spread that good news until the end of time. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we thank you on this second Sunday of Advent as we anticipate the arrival of the Christ child. May our preparation be constant and consistent with our faith that we prayerfully each and every day look forward to his coming and welcoming him in our hearts this day and always. Be in our worship as we join together in this morning hour. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, dear ones, let's take a moment to share a greeting with those around us. Thank you, Angel Choir. That was Junior Praise. Excuse me. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Brent, Miss Julie. Beautiful music. Could invite the rest of the children to come on down and share in our morning message. Yeah, we want to turn around, look out this way. You might want to come towards Pastor John a little bit. Have a seat. We'll sit down here. Sit here. We're going to see something special.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
These are my eyeblast friends, and normally when we do children's message, you see us up here with puppets. But our puppets are busy getting ready for Santa breakfast, so I hope you all come next Saturday so you get to see our puppets at Santa breakfast, okay? But these are my friends, and they decided they're getting a little bolder, and they thought they could come out from behind the stage this morning, and they have a message to share with you, okay? So, guys, you ready? All right, so they have a message to share with you. Go ahead. Wait a minute. Can anybody read that? No, me neither. Wait, okay, hang on a minute, okay? Guys, you might not be awake, all right? I know you have a message, okay? So can you try again? All right, go ahead, okay. So just give them a minute. They're smart kids. I know they can spell, right? I hope they can spell. All right, we'll see. All right, so, all right. Got it this time? All right, what's your message? Okay, guys, you're all in middle school and high school, right? You guys have spelling, right? You probably can spell better than they can. Okay, guys, the bishop's here, okay? So, should we give him one more chance? All right, guys, giving you one more chance, okay? See if you can get your message together, okay? Because these guys are just ready to hear from you. Okay, go ahead. Let's see if we can. Do you think they can do this? Think they can spell? All right, let's see. Making me nervous. All right, I feel better. Okay, let me see your message here, guys. Oh, okay, we're okay. Can anybody read that for me? God is nowhere. Whoa, God is nowhere. Who can read it for me now? Who can read it for me now?
God is now here.
God is now here. That's right. Is this your message, guys? Okay. You know what? Sometimes, though, just like that one letter, do we ever feel in our life like God isn't there? You know, bad things happen, and we say, where's God? Or, you know, we're going through a tough time, and we feel like God's not there, but you know what? Just like that one little letter moving, sometimes we just need to move a little bit. Sometimes we need to reach out. We need to say a prayer. We need to. But you know what? In that time, God isn't the one that moved. We're the one that moved, right? And our message, God is now here, that's what Advent is all about, right? Jesus coming, God sending his son, Jesus, as a baby to Christmas so that he can be here with us all the time and that each one of you can have a personal relationship with Jesus. That's what Christmas is. It's all about. So, thanks, guys. I'm glad we got it. We'll work on some of practice. We'll work on some spelling, okay? So I'm going to turn that over to Pastor John right now.
Thank you, guys. That was a wonderful message. Let me ask you children something. How many of you ever went to a birthday party? How many of you actually had a birthday party at your house? Was it fun to be invited? You always had a lot of fun there? Well, you know, we're having a birthday party here at Grace on Christmas Eve. We're going to celebrate that the baby Jesus is going to be born. Yeah. Now, we know that there are some friends that don't get invited. Maybe a neighbor of yours that doesn't have a church family. Maybe it's someone you go to school with. Maybe it's a relative. Mm-hmm. You're at school, yeah. You're here right now, and we're excited about that. I wish everybody would be this excited to be here. Oh, that's right. I promised to be good today. So, our little elves put a gift together for you. It has a wonderful devotions that you and your mommy and daddy can read each day, and a special cup that talks about the Savior. And then there's a special gift in there for you to give to a friend who might not have a church family. They could come here and to celebrate Jesus' birthday, just like you celebrate your birthday and your friend's birthday. So we're going to have a prayer together, and then you're just going to stand, and my little friends are going to come down and help. Everyone will leave here with a package like this, okay? All right, let's put our hands together. Close your eyes and you pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you for this special day. Help us to touch others. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, stand up in place. Everybody's going to get a gift. Okay, the youth are going to help. We got them. We got it covered. There you go. If you want to raise your hand, we'll see that you get one.
Good morning, everyone. We're going to listen to two books this morning, and both of them are from the New Testament. The first one is Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making my prayer with joy. Thankful for your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel those thus about you all, because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruits of righteousness which come through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. The second book is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 68 to 79. And these are the words of Prophet Zechariah as he's filled with the Holy Spirit. And just to remind you that Zechariah was the father of John the Baptist. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the home of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him, all the days of our life. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, when the day shall dawn upon us from on high to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Betty, for sharing God's word with us today. Just a couple of prayer requests. Janet Warner is not doing well. They're going to be calling in hospice. To my knowledge, she's now been gone from the hospital to Twin Oaks. I want to keep her and Bud in our prayers, two dear saints in our church. Arlene Bruner is also in the hospital. We want to keep Arlene in our prayers, as is Ashley Bonner. On a joy, my little prayer warriors, I asked you 2 weeks ago and to sign up last week, I needed 120 people that would commit to praying every day for church, pastor, staff, community, and church leaders. And as of now, we have 128. I'm so proud of you. So thank you. I'm feeling that energy. You can feel it in the church. I can see it in the daycare and the preschool, the energy. And you're saying, well, that's because we're getting closer to Christmas. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And thank you, 8:30 and 9:35 folks, for coming out at a different time schedule. We will be back to our normal schedules next Sunday. Are there any other joys or concerns you would want to lift up this morning? Yes.
The Harry Bowman family.
Harry Bowman family, we'll keep in our prayers. Thank you. Yes, Randy. Keep your mother in our prayers. She's also in hospice, and I know you've been dealing with that. And Randy's been asked to go back on the road with, what is her name? Carrie Underwood, thank you. And Bruce Springsteen. So that poor fellow's got all kinds of things going on, good and bad. So we'll keep you in our prayers as well. Yes, Kathy? Frank Kugel, the lost co-worker.
Carrie lost the father, Frank.
Okay, we'll keep Carrie and family in our prayers. Thank you. If you go online, the Susquehanna Conference is a beautiful letter that Bishop Hart wrote concerning some of the sadness that has hit our country and around the world. I would welcome you to do that. It's worth publishing. Let us now enter into a time of silent prayer and meditation. Lord, we do thank you for this special time that comes yearly, reminding us that you fulfilled your promise in your Son, our Lord Jesus, that you would humble yourself to come as a child, being born in a stable, loving us and teaching us and healing us, even when we reject you. Help us at some point in the preparation for this season to sit quietly and be mindful that you continue to work in and through the world, that we are your hands and feet, that we can continue to share the good news that Jesus saves souls, that there is a life here and a life eternal. Help us to put aside those things that separate us and to endure the hardships and the struggling and the suffering that comes our way. We pray for the neglected, for the poor and the homeless. We pray for those who are suffering this day or who have lost loved ones or will soon bidding loved ones farewell. Strengthen us with the light of your eternity that we might see beyond this life and put our trust and hope in you. And we ask that you send again your Son to our world, that he might do for us what we are unable to do for ourselves. We pray these things in the Master's name, for our Lord has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the season of giving, of generosity, of hope and joy. So let us continue to support our church with the same kind of energy and excitement as we shop around for our families. Ushers, come forward as we continue to support the ministry and mission of our church.
Thank you. Greetings to you in the name of Jesus Christ, Prince of Peace, healer of our brokenness and hope of the world. I wish you and your loved ones a blessed season of Advent. Today we lighted a second candle of Advent for peace. When our memory of the horrible tragedy of San Bernardino, California is still fresh, I would like to have a moment of prayer in the spirit of Advent for peace. So let's be in an attitude of prayer. O God, we pause in silence and reflection because once again evil has invaded sharply into our world with all its vengeance and power. We pray in solidarity with those who are directly affected by the recent terrorist acts. We are particularly mindful of the persons who have lost their lives and their families and loved ones. We also lift up for healing those who were injured and fighting to live. May they have a sense of assurance that you are with them even in these darkest days. We ask your comforting, caring, and healing presence to surround them and strengthen them. Oh God, we also pray that you provide wisdom and courage for those who must lead and respond in the midst of the horrendous tragedy. God, you are the creator and author of this life, and when you looked at that creation after every act, you declared it good. Truly, the world in which we inhabit is magnificent with the hues of humanity, and everywhere we look, we see evidence of your creative power, presence, and beauty. You intended for humanity to live in harmony with you, nature, with each other, and our own selves. May we learn how to live together in peace and with a respect for all persons, regardless of race, color, creed, or religion. To that end, O God, we once again commit and recommit to work for peace in the world. As the hymn writer expressed it, let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. We pray these spoken and unspoken words in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior we worship, the Prince of Peace we follow, healer of our brokenness we represent, and hope of the world we proclaim. Amen. Thanks be to God that I have this privilege of celebrating the second Advent Sunday with the awesome people of God, Grace United Methodist Church here in Homerstown. I hear that Grace United Methodist Church, Homerstown, is one of the strongest churches we have in our conference. Thanks be to God for you. We need more churches like Grace among us. And thanks be to God for the ministry and leadership of Reverend John Schaefer among you. Under his spiritual and pastoral leadership, Grace United Methodist Church continues to be thriving in faithful ministry and fruitful mission. We need more pastors like Pastor John. Amen. And thank you, Barbara, for your partnership in this ministry together. And I also personally would like to thank your pastor for his serving as chair of Superintendent's Committee of Harrisburg District. I also would like to thank Audrey, Director of Young People's Ministry of the Conference, for your ministry with us. And thank Jack for your support for her ministry. Thank Louis Hutchinson. Where are you, Louis? Over there. For her serving as chancellor of our conference, she is an invaluable asset to the cabinet, the conference, as well as to me. Thank you, Louis. Your district superintendent, Reverend Barry Robinson, is not here with us, but I would like you to know that he's an outstanding gift to me and the cabinet, as well as to the Harrisburg District and conference. And thanks to God for his presence, leadership, and ministry among us. I have the best cabinet I can ask for, and he is one of the reasons why I can say it with confidence and a sense of privilege. Wow, this is a beautiful sanctuary. It's an awesome place to worship our God. By now, probably you have noticed that I speak with an accent. This is a Korean accent. Lisa and I immigrated to this country 39 years ago. By that time, we were already married. I already served a church in Seoul, Methodist church there. But I have two children, both of them born in this country, made in USA. And I started my process to be ordained in the United Methodist Church. And one of the requirements was to prepare a sermon in English. So for the first time in my life, I prepared a sermon and preached in English some years ago. And the text was given, Matthew 16, verses 16 and following. You remember the story? One day Jesus asked of the disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered that you are the John the Baptist, you are the Elijah, and you are one of the prophets. And Jesus was not happy with that answer, so he asked one more time, "Then who do you say that I am?" Of course, Peter stood up and said that you are the Christ, Son of the living God. And Jesus was so happy with his answer, so he responded, "You know, your name is Peter, meaning rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." And that was the text. So I preached for the first time in my life a sermon in English I prepared. And when the service was over, I greeted the people who came for the service. Each one by one shook our hands, and I said, "Thank you." And at one point, an elderly lady came to me, and she said, and looked at me and said that, "Are you a Baptist?" she asked. So I was really puzzled by her question. So I said, no, I'm a Methodist. My father was a Methodist pastor in Korea. I want to be a pastor in the Methodist church. Why are you asking that question?" And she said that, "Didn't you talk about Baptist something today?" So I remembered that I mentioned the name John the Baptist because it appeared in the text. So I told her that, "Oh, you mean the John the Baptist?" And she told me that, "Oh, I thought you were talking about John the Baptist." So that's my Korean accent. But this is a beautiful day, isn't it? Awesome day. And wow, God knew that Bishop was coming. Wow. So in a day like this, in celebration of this Advent awesome worship, I would like to shout, "Praise the Lord." Can you say that? Praise the Lord. I would like to teach you how to say "praise the Lord" in Korean. Is it okay? Yeah. Are you ready? But you've got to shout though, right? Hallelujah!
Hallelujah.
Whoa, I'm impressed. Do you know how to say "I'm impressed" in Korean? Whoa! I'm known as a singing bishop. I love to sing. Oh, thank you for just awesome choir. Oof. God bless you. We are blessed. And the children's choir and the handbell choir, and this is an awesome congregation. The music, appreciate it. Some people know that I have a karaoke machine at home. Singing hymns and songs of praise and witness lifts up my spirit and feeds my soul. I cannot pass by a special moment that I'm having with God's people of grace without singing my favorite hymn. Is it okay? We'll sing together? Number 77, "How Great Thou Art." Okay. If you are able, we will stand and we'll sing the first, third, and fourth. First, third, and fourth.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, I power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is so unsparing, send him to die, I scarce can take it in. And on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. This is my kind of congregation.
I asked your pastor, how long does it usually preach?
I don't know why you are laughing now. But it's my understanding that this is a combined worship service, right? Three worship services together. So I have the privilege of preaching three times longer.
Some of the responsibilities that bishops are often called upon to do is to be a guest preacher at local congregations. Frederick Buchner, a well-known, respected writer and theologian, often identified this type of preaching as tourist preaching. He meant by that phrase that the preacher is an outsider who comes into the life of the congregation and proclaims a message and then departs as quickly as he or she came. Well, today I may appear like a tourist preacher, but I would like you to know that I'm not here as a visitor or a guest, let alone a tourist. Grace United Methodist Church is my church. This is my parish. Your ministry is my ministry, it's our ministry. Your challenge is my challenge, it's our common challenge. And your future is my future, it's our future together. Why do I say this? The United Methodist Church is a connectional church in a most significant and essential way. There are over 870 United Methodist congregations in the Susquehanna Annual Conference, but all of them are connected
with one another as one church. We are a church together, and we are better together. That's what a connectional church is all about. In the spirit of the connectionalism of our church, I would like you to know that though I leave after the service and a time of fellowship, I don't depart from the Grace United Methodist Church, Hummerstown. The connection we share will never end. Once again, I would like to say this out of deep appreciation of who we are as a connectional church. We are a church together, and we are better together. So I pray that by the grace of God, I will bring the word of grace today that would bless our common journey as God's people of one church. Today's lectionary reading of Philippians chapter 1 is one of my favorite passages. In celebration of who we are as a connectional church, I would like to lift up a couple of points. First, I would like to celebrate the joyful partnership we share in the gospel. Paul's letter to the church at Philippi is one of the most cordial and affectionate we have from Paul's hand. This congregation was the first congregation established by Paul on European soil. There is uncertainty as to exactly when it was written, but nonetheless, Paul and this congregation had a strong bonds of love and respect for one another. For certain, the occasion for the letter written was a return to Philippi of Epaphroditus, who had been sent by the church with a gift to Paul, who most likely has been in prison at that time. Paul took this opportunity to thank them and in particular to share what was in his heart with his beloved church of Philippi. He starts this letter with thanking God for the fond memories he shared with the congregation at Philippi. I thank my God every time I remember you. And then he says, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel. Whenever I read the word joy in the Bible, my heart rejoices because I want to be an evangelist of joy, of the good news of God. I want every church in the Susquehanna Annual Conference to be a joyful church more than anything else. You may remember the words of the angel who appeared to the shepherds in the field to make the greatest announcement that the world ever heard. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. We are the people of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. The good news of great joy. If we don't have joy, what's the point? Without joy, we are missing the point. Gospel and joy go together. It was wonderful to see children coming together and have that special moment. And, as a bishop, I received different kinds of questions. Questions like, Bishop, what's your understanding of youth ministry or children's ministry? My answer sounds something like this. You know, it's not something we do for them. Rather, it means who we are when we are with them. The children and youth, they are not the future of our church. They are the present of our church. Let them be the partners in mission and witness and mission today. That's who they are. So I'm so excited to see many children and young people among us and with us. My greetings with them sounds like this. You know, I'm so happy to see you here in our church. This is your church now. We are your partners in ministry now. And the other question I receive is, Bishop, we would like to have more people and more resources for ministry. Can you help us? It's wonderful to see these many people in one place and being in worship together. So my answer sounds like this. For our church to grow, two things have to happen. One, we've got to have more visitors. Second, they've got to stay with us. And of course, Bishop, we would like to have more people visiting with us and stay with us. How can we do that? I would like to say that if the people in this community find this church a joyful community, more people would like to visit with us, and they would like to stay with us. Of course, Bishop, we would like to have more people coming with us and be a joyful church. How can you be a joyful church? I'm going to sing a couple of songs. Is it okay? I am the church. We are the church. You are the church. We are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we are the church together. And church is not a steeple. Church is not a building. Church is not a resting place. But church is people. Joyful people make a joyful church. You may ask, where does this joy come from? Somehow I learned this song when I was growing up in Korea, in English. If you know this song, please join me. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart, down in my heart, down in my heart. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart, down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. If you know the love of Jesus, then you know what kind of joy we are talking about. The joy that the world cannot give. The joy that the world cannot take away from us. Joy. Is a witness to who we are as God's people. The gospel, good news of great joy. Everyone has his or her own favorite bear story, but this is my favorite one. Two people were hiking in deep mountain, and suddenly they encountered a bear. Threatened, bear stood up and made a threatening gesture. So one person slowly took off the backpack and dropped the water bottle, emptied the pockets. So the other one is asking, you think you can really outrun the bear? And this person answered, no, all I have to do is to outrun you. We are living in a world where self-interest trumps everything. But here we are as God's people to give a witness to an alternative vision of the world. It's a vision of a beloved community where all peoples are accepted and formed as children of God and experience and share genuine love for one another. The love of God in Jesus Christ makes this vision of a beloved community a reality where real and true joy is present. Not simply present, but overflowing. Love and joy go together. Let's be reminded of what Jesus says of love and joy in the Gospel of John, chapter 15. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's command and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this, love one another as I have loved you. Message, genuine love and complete joy go together. God's people, we represent a beloved community where love abounds and joy overflows. The love of God in Jesus Christ makes it possible. Let the church say amen. The theme of our annual conference, I don't know whether you know this or not, is Alive in Christ Together. What does a church alive in Christ look like? We can say it different ways, but I can say that a singing church is a church alive. I'm a singing bishop, what do you expect? Praising church is a church alive. And it's okay, once in a while, dancing church is a church alive. Particularly with our young people that dance. Praying church is church alive. Serving church is a church alive. Giving thanks is a church alive. Church mission is a church alive. But I would like to say that one more thing. A joyful church is a church alive. As God's people of the gospel, the good news of great joy, we have many reasons for joy. However, Paul lifts up one particular reason for joy in today's passage that means so much to our journey as God's people. He says, I pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel. Like Paul, I would like to celebrate the reason for joy that we have. That is our partnership in the gospel, and that this partnership is making a difference in the world today. That's an awesome reason for joy. 2006 was a very special year to me and to Lisa. We visited Africa for the first time. The Council of Bishops had its meeting in Maputo, the capital city of Mozambique, to make a statement that we are a global church. We had a wonderful time there, and during our meeting, one afternoon, we received a surprise gift. Do you know what happened? Nelson Mandela visited with us. So that was an awesome moment to be in his presence. But by that time, he was physically very weak, so he couldn't speak that much. But he offered the words of welcome, briefly talked about his connection with our church. And then his wife, Michelle, gave a personal testimony in terms of her connection with our church. When her mother delivered her, she died. But our church adopted her and raised and nurtured her to be one of the top leaders of the world today. The Time magazine named her one of the 100 most influential leaders of the world today, a couple of years ago. Wow! That's the kind of church we are, God's people. And when the meeting was over, I visited several mission sites which had a direct connection with the United Methodist Church. Wherever I visited, they were so excited and happy to see me. And they told me that, Bishop, we are so happy to see you here. You came from the United States. And then they told me that when you go back to your people, please say thank you on our behalf. Because your mission connection with us does make a difference in the lives of so many people in this part of the world. So I promise that I will do that. This is my moment to do it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, and thank you. Your presence here at Grace United Methodist Church does make a difference in the world. Last year was a very special year to me. About 35 people of our conference visited my homeland where I was born and raised, Korea. We had a wonderful time there. One Methodist church invited us to experience some spiritual pilgrimage program, and then we experienced the hospitality of the Korean church and the vitality of the congregation in a powerful way. And then at one point, the pastor told us this. You know, we would like to offer this kind of opportunity without really charging anything. I mean, all we had to do was paying the airfare, and everything else was taken care of. I think that the message was freely received and freely given. And the pastor told us that, you know, we used to be a receiving church, but we are now a giving church. We are sending missionaries all over the world. And then he told us that we are offering this kind of opportunity to you because we are so thankful to you. So I said, wow, what's so thankful to us? 130 years ago, our people didn't know Jesus Christ. We didn't have the gospel. But you sent the missionary who brought the gospel, and that changed the destiny of Korean people. Wow. I live in Mechanicsburg. That's about 50 miles from Lancaster. Do you know the Lancaster is the birthplace of Korean Methodism? A young man by the name of Henry Appenzeller was nurtured in a Methodist church there and became the first missionary from our church who came to Korea, 1885. And then literally, he gave his life. He died in Korea. Wow. And the gospel traveled the whole world and made a full cycle. Here I am, your bishop. What an awesome God we worship and serve. I was born in 1950. Now you know my age. When the Korean War broke out. If America did not come, I would not be here, as you know. This past Veterans Day, I was invited to a group of gathering of God's people, of our people, in appreciation of what they have sacrificed, the veterans, on our behalf. And I had a personal privilege in telling them that, you know, without you coming to our country, in defense of our freedom and protect the lives of Korean people, the Korea, as you know, it would not be there today. There would not be no Kia, no Hyundai, no Samsung, no LG, you know, life is good. Even no Gangnam Style. God bless America. It's my very personal. You brought the gospel. You defended Korean people. And here I am. Praise and glory to God that we are the partners in the wonder-working power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this partnership is making a real difference in so many parts of the world today. The second point, in spirit of Advent, I would like you to embrace a future filled with hope. Paul has these words in today's message, being confident of this, that God who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ. Let me share this story. A mother was shouting from downstairs, Jimmy, it's time to get up to go to school. There was no response. A little later, she shouted again, Jimmy, if you don't get up now, you will be late for school. There was still no response. Finally, the mother went upstairs and opened the bedroom door and shouted, Jimmy, get up right now. Jimmy answered, Mommy, I don't want to go to school. I hate my school. All teachers hate me. All children hate me. Give me a good reason why I should go to school. The mother said, I have two good reasons why. First, you are 42 years old. And second, you are the principal. We all have days like Jimmy. After hearing this story, someone came to me after the worship, said, Bishop, you've got to change something in the story. Change principal to pastor. It is true that many of our churches are having a very tough time. We know that we are facing a tremendous challenge to be a church for such a time as this. There are many things that make us disappointed and even discouraged, but we can envision a future filled with hope. Hearing what Paul is saying, God who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ. It is not about us. It is about our God. It is about what God can, will, and do, not about what we can do and will do. So wherever I go, I would like to share a message of hope with our church. Why? God knows the best and God is in charge. And that's why. God knows that the church is the best chance that God has for transforming this world by making disciples of Jesus Christ. It is God who started the church with that mission in mind, and God will complete what he started. Paul envisioned the future filled with hope because he was confident in God's faithfulness and ability to complete what he started.
Today's lectionary reading of Zechariah's song in Luke carries the same message. Bless the Lord God of Israel, because he has come to help and has delivered his people. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in his servant David's house, just as he said through the mouth of the holy prophets long ago. He has brought salvation from our enemies and from the power of all who hate us. He has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and remembered his holy covenant, the solemn pledge made to our ancestor Abraham. Message: God honors the promise he has made. God does according to what he said. God remembers the covenant made with his people, and God fulfills what he pledges. God completes. What is promised? The Church of Jesus Christ is from God and of God. God was, is, and will be in charge of the church until the day of Christ Jesus. Indeed, our hope lies in the God who called us to be the church. You know, when Jesus died on the cross, there was an intriguing story of a man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea, a very rich man, influential person, came to Pilate boldly and asked for the body of Jesus to be buried in a tomb that he prepared for himself. So somebody asked him, Joseph, you must have prepared the nice, best kind of tomb for yourself. Why did you give it up for Jesus? And he answered that, because I knew that he would be staying there just for the weekend. Don't quote me on this, because that part is not in the Bible. We worship and serve the living God who raised Jesus from the dead. With this God, hope lives on. So God's people of Grace Hummerstown, take heart. It was the risen Christ who gave the mission of the church, go and make disciples of all nations. It was the risen Christ who also gave us the promise, I will be with you till the end of the age. We have the absolute assurance that our God will be with us until the day of Christ. And we have all the confidence that God will complete what he started in and through God's people of Jesus Christ. So therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, for we know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
prayer. God, we give you thanks for this time of God's people gathered together in praise of you and have a special moment of hearing your message and be once again committing ourselves. It's the powerful, wonder-working love of God in Jesus Christ. And we give you thanks for the fellowship that we are going to have. Bless the meal so that we can be strengthened, body, mind, and soul, for the task ahead. And help us not to neglect those who do not have the choice to have food on the table on a daily basis. So have mercy upon them, and have mercy upon us. So we'll continue to be faithful, and even fruitful evermore, all to your glory. So now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you, and towards you, and toward this broken world, and give us healing in the places of brokenness and hurt. Love in our heart, joy in our spirit, future in our journey ahead, and shalom in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.